So our next presentation is from Dave Warner with USGS. We have a lot of really interesting things going on with crayfish monitoring. That's always a topic of interest at this workshop. So we've given Dave a full hour here. And again, for folks participating, try to keep the chat to a minimum because this is a long talk and we're going to have plenty of time at the end for questions coming in by chat. And again, after the entire morning session at 11:30, when we break, we're going to keep this open and we can have people turn their cameras on and turn their mics on, and we can have some dialogue with Dave and Chuck at 11:30 in a longer format. So again, try to hold your questions by chat and just type in short questions that are directly related to Dave's talk over the next hour or so. We'll try to have Dave address those at the end, but then we'll circle back for the longer discussions with the mics on at 11:30. So thanks, Dave. You're all set.
Thank you. Morning, everybody. Thanks for the opportunity to be here. I have to admit that for some reason, I'm a little nervous today about doing a talk. I don't normally feel nervous when I'm doing these things. So, what I'm going to talk to you about today is a pretty wide range of stuff that we've been working on with crayfish at USGS and in collaboration with Fish and Wildlife Service and Michigan DNR. Hopefully, people will be happy that we actually do have results from the 2022 surveys this year after probably close to 2 decades on the job here at USGS. I've finally reached the point of us consistently having preliminary results available to present at a January meeting with the Lake Michigan Technical Committee. So that is a big success in my mind. The big thing we're missing at this point is honestly just age-specific information for alewife. And we've got 500 plus alewife to age from 4 different ships, and it takes a while. We expect it'll be done before too long, though. Just to sort of guide the process here, we're going to talk about a quick recap of the spring 2022 bottom trawl survey results. A lot of you may not have heard about those results. We'll talk about preliminary results from the 2022 annual surveys. They're the surveys we conduct in August and September. I'll talk a little bit about some of the advanced tech activities that we've been undertaking to try and learn how to do a better job of carrying out acoustic surveys. And I'll try to cover a little bit of information for our plans for work in 2023. So there has been for many, many years difference in when bottom trawl surveys happen in two primary alewife lakes in the Great Lakes. In Lake Michigan, the bottom trawl survey that has been one of the primary sources of alewife information has typically been carried out in the fall, whereas in Lake Ontario, this survey has been carried out in the spring. And in response to some beliefs that we might improve our estimates for alewife by sampling in the spring, our biologist Ralph Tingley has started doing that. And this year will be a new year. So one of the key things to remember is that in addition to sampling in May, which is very different from September, Ralph has added deeper bottom sites to this survey because in Lake Ontario, they have observed that alewife tend to be very, very far out offshore in very deep water in the spring. So the take-home message is, what we're seeing is that the spring results tend to be similar to the fall forage results and the August acoustic survey results. So for 2022, The catch that was observed at these dark or filled circles in the map on the right represent mostly deep water sculpin, bloater, burbot, and alewife. And one of the neat things that seems to be coming out of this for alewife is that alewife do tend to be staying out deeper for a longer period of time than before quagga mussels. This graph here shows the gram per hectare density of alewife in the spring survey. And you can see it peaks pretty far off, 150 meters, which is close to 500 feet. That's pretty deep compared to where we historically would see them in the past. Of course, saying, you know, we're talking about a pre-dracaenid comparison now puts us in a pretty long-term comparison because dracaenids have been in the lake for so long. We don't completely know why the alewife are staying offshore longer. I'm not even prepared to speculate on that, but I will say it's pretty clear they're doing it. So in the results that we have so far, we see that the biomass for alewife that are what I'll call yearlings and olders. Those are fish that are at least a year old or greater. Those are fish that we think are captured relatively well with a bottom trawl survey. The biomass is pretty low relative to any kind of longer term data. In 2021, 85% of the alewife that were caught were yearlings, which is pretty unusual because historically in the fall surveys that we carry out using the bottom trawl, age one alewife are really a small proportion of the total alewife captured. And we've never really known exactly why, other than to, you know, conclude that these age one alewife don't spend time on the bottom the way older alewife do. So they're not available to that bottom trawl in the fall. So the bottom range that's sampled in these surveys, the spring surveys, is pretty phenomenal. It doesn't get much deeper than 239 meters bottom depth in Lake Michigan. I think the maximum that I'm aware of is 275 meters. And the portion of the lake that is 275 meters is really, really tiny. So, you know, the fact that Ralph's getting out there to do these tows is pretty great. Some of these deep tows can take over an hour just to get the trawl down and back. So I notice I've got a typo here, and I apologize for that. That I have up above should say, instead of 0.19, it should say 0.38. And that's because I failed to change it in both places. I only changed it in the table. Sorry about that. But we can see that this table, we have three different surveys in here. One is the 2021 acoustic survey estimate, one is the fall 2021 bottom trawl estimate, and one is the spring 2022 bottom trawl estimate. And we can see that the right two estimates, both of them from the bottom trawl survey, are quite a bit lower than the estimates we have from the 2021 acoustic survey. That's something that's been pretty consistent for a while. It's not new. Beginning in about 2014, we started seeing really much lower abundance estimates from our bottom trawl survey than we had in the past, whereas the two types of surveys, the acoustic and the bottom trawl survey were often sort of similar. Now they're not. Can also see that, you know, there's a pretty high level of similarity between the fall 2021 and spring 2022 bottom trawl data. There's really not much difference between 0.5 and 0.38 kilograms per hectare. So now I'm going to talk to you about the 2022 Lake Michigan Acoustic Survey, which, as is typical, was carried out by three vessels, three agencies, USGS, US Fish and Wildlife Service, and Michigan DNR. In this particular year, we're really grateful that Michigan DNR was around to help for another year, because we had some vessel issues at USGS that caused us to have to start pretty late. So I'll try to compare actually all of the survey work here. And what I have in the map here on the right-hand side is the locations of the fall sampling that's done in the acoustic survey, where we actually have ping samples, that's in the blue squares, the bottom trawl survey, which is sort of the orange-ish circles, and finally the midwater trawl locations that typically happen along the acoustic transect that are shown in the, I guess I call them magenta or pink triangles. So we covered a pretty large range of bottom depths in the acoustic survey, from 5 to 255 meters. The mean is about 88 meters, which is actually pretty similar to the mean depth of Lake Michigan. In this latest year, we had 37 midwater tows, and my next bullet says about 400 alewife to age. As it turns out, we found some additional ones, so we're up over 500 at this point. And the processing, or the age processing, is pretty close to being done. We have a method where we have repeated reads of these aging structures, which are ear bones or otoliths, by multiple readers, to try and determine which of these fish age estimates agree upon. So that process of doing sort of the level of agreement and the quality control is what's happening right now. So the bottom trawl survey, which is shown again in these orange dots, was about 80 tows in 2022, which included six deeper tows that have been added to this September survey for the past, I want to say 6 or 7 years. That addition of those deeper tows was made because it was clear that there were some fish that were on bottom further offshore or at deeper bottom depths than were being sampled by the bottom trawl survey. So it just made sense to try and extend that depth range. So this slide here shows our time series for what we call yearling and older alewife from both surveys. The plot on the left, the two different lines show the two different surveys. The blue line is the acoustic survey. The black line is the bottom trawl survey. And the units for these lines, the number of kilograms per hectare. And right away, you can see a big difference in the length of these lines. That's because we really didn't start what I would call rigorous lake-wide acoustic surveys until about 2004, whereas the bottom trawl survey has been sampling the whole lake, or what they call the whole lake, since 1973. And looking at the portion of the plot where both surveys were taking place, you can see up until about 2004, 2014 or so, or 2015 or so, there's a lot of either overlap or similarity between the blue line and the black line. In some years, the blue line is lower. In some years, the blue line is higher. In some years, the blue and black lines are almost identical. And then all of a sudden, black line just drops and sort of flatlines up through almost the present, while what we see in the blue line is more abundance or higher abundance, and almost looks like there could be an increasing trend from the early 2010 period, but it's tough to say. One thing you'll notice here is there's no data point for 2020. We were not able to carry out the acoustic survey in 2020 because of COVID. Basically, we didn't have a system set up for us to be out on the ships safely. So that wasn't my call necessarily, but it's too bad. On the right-hand side is a map showing the data that were averaged to go into the graph on the left-hand side. And each data point represents either an acoustic sample or a bottom trawl sample. And looking at this, what one can see is that the color and size of the symbols varies from dark and small at low densities to lighter and larger at higher densities. Given that pattern, you can see that there's what I would call two areas of relatively higher alewife biomass for the yearling and older. This is something we see pretty commonly up in the area of the Door Peninsula off Washington Island. In that area, we often see higher alewife densities that we think are the result of fish that are sourced from Green Bay, in addition to there being actual fish that can come from Green Bay. There's also typically higher productivity in the water near the Door Peninsula as a result of the closeness to Green Bay. Higher chlorophyll, higher phosphorus, and that sort of thing. There's also often an area of higher density in the southeastern portion of the Michigan shoreline. That's true in 2022, like it has been in numerous years. This plot is focused on age zero alewife, which we really only report from the acoustic survey. And that's because we feel like the acoustic survey is the one that does the best job of sampling these fish. We just don't see that many typically in the bottom trawl survey because they're not on bottom. We can see that there's a lot of variation in the height of this blue line that's representing the number of fish per hectare. And we can see that the peaks that have occurred show up in a few years, but not very many. That's because what we see with young of year alewife, or with alewife, the alewife population in general, is these irregular, really large year classes, the years where there are a lot of young of year alewife produced, and other years there just aren't very many produced at all. And two of the biggest year classes we've seen in the time series were 2005 and 2010. I'm pretty sure that if we'd been able to conduct acoustic surveys in 1998, we would have seen a year class even larger than these two, but we just didn't have acoustic surveys happening at that point in time. You can see from about 2014 or 15 onward, we really haven't had what I would call a strong year class. We have had probably about average densities of young of year alewife. This is pretty important to note because the abundance of alewife at age zero is, we think, influential to the abundance and growth of Chinook salmon later, the following year. You know, the connection between Chinook and alewife, as you guys and gals probably all know, is pretty tight. So the Chinook can really key in on the alewife when there's a lot of young, or the young of your alewife when there's a lot of them, just because of how abundant they are. From the distribution perspective, what we saw in 2022 for young of your alewife was a little different than what we've seen in some years, but honestly, we don't know that there's any pattern in where these high densities of young of your alewife occur. It can be really variable, high in, you know, one place one year and not high there the next year. But in 2022, we found the highest densities off the Garden Peninsula, off the Door Peninsula, and in the far southern offshore portion of the lake. It's pretty common for there to be high densities in the southern portion of the lake, not as common to see those higher densities in the northern portion of the lake. Next, we're going to talk about bloater. Bloater are an interesting species. They used to support a pretty sizable commercial fishery. They don't really anymore. They are still important ecologically, I'd argue, even though they don't support a commercial fishery, and even though there aren't a lot of indicators that predators are eating these fish. This plot is set up, or pair of plots is set up a little differently. On the left-hand side is large bloater that are more than 120 millimeters long. And on the right side is small bloater that are less than 120 millimeters long. And like the alewife plot for both surveys that I showed before, you can see there's really no data available to us in later or in earlier years. And the plot labeled plot A shows that bloater biomass, according to the bottom trawl, was really, really high in the late 1970s through probably the late 1990s, and decreased pretty drastically from that point in time, and has been relatively flat for a number of years. There is evidence when you look at this later time period from about 2015 onward, in a more zoomed in fashion, that there's an increasing trend, which I'll show you in a minute. The plot labeled B here on the right hand side, as I indicated, is smaller bloater. And we can see even the smaller bloater were showing up at really, really high levels in the late 70s to early 90s, which is evidence of pretty strong recruitment coming from these massive numbers of adult bloater. We can see virtually no small bloater in the bottom trawl survey for a period of about 10 years. And then when we started the acoustic survey, all of a sudden we started seeing small bloater showing up here and there with peaks much like we see in the alewife. And we actually saw in 2021 in the acoustic survey the largest density of small bloater that we've ever seen in the acoustic survey. This has been followed by increases in small bloater in the bottom trawl survey. I mentioned a minute ago that I was going to try and zoom in on this plot. So that's what I've done in this plot. The left-hand plot is still the larger bloater. I wouldn't call them yearling and older anymore. We've discovered that that's actually not the case. And the right is the small bloater. It's still labeled age zero because that's how we presented it in January to the Lake Michigan Technical Committee. The caveat that I have to share and that was shared there is we've recently been able to look at age composition data of these bloater that we just didn't have available to us until recently that tells us that most of the fish on the right-hand plot are not age zero. Only about 20% of those fish are age zero. So that's why in the prior slide, I called them small. You can see though, in the left-hand plot, you look at the blue line and starting in about 2010, it looks like there's been an increasing trend in the biomass of adult bloater. And there's starting to be evidence of the same thing happening in the black line, the bottom trawl survey. I argue pretty strongly that that change in the blue and black lines on the left-hand side starting in about 2017 is the result of the peaks in the blue line on the right-hand side in 2015 and 2016. We had really high numbers of, or let me rephrase that, relatively high numbers of small bloater in 2015 and 16. And if you look at the age composition of the larger fish in subsequent years, it's clear that those fish came from these 2015 and 2016 abundances of small bloater. So I think it's important to note that the period 2017 to 21, bloater became the dominant portion of fish biomass, and now they're co-dominant, whereas before alewife were dominant. Unfortunately, there's not much evidence that other fish eat the bloater, and the commercial fishery, as I said earlier, is essentially gone. But I think it's really key to focus on the fact that bloater may be a key driver of mysis abundance because they rely very heavily on mysis as food, like a lot of other fish. Virtually every fish in the lake eats mysis at some point in time. So we really need to understand why the bloater variability is occurring and why they're increasing, even though some of the more historic reasons for studying them might be gone. And this requires us to have good age information, which has been delayed until recently because of a shift to otoliths for aging. So rainbow smelt are another historically important species. And they're another species that we can see on the left in the bottom trawl and acoustic survey have declined in their adult or yearling and older abundance quite a bit. Basically, they've been low in the bottom trawl survey since the early 2000s, and there's really not much evidence that they're coming back. They're still out there, we just don't see very many of them. I think if you were to zoom in, as I did for the bloater, you can focus a little bit more on some of the changes that are happening recently because it changes the scale of the plot. You can see that in the most recent years, both the acoustic survey and bottom trawl survey show that there looks to be some an increase in the larger rainbow smelt, but that increase is not bringing them back to a level where we observed them in 2004 to 2006. Round goby, obviously, are an important species. A lot of fish eat them, and one thing we can say is that we really only measure these things with the bottom trawl survey. We will get young of year gobies up in the water column with our midwater trawl during the acoustic survey, but not in any kind of reliable measure. What we see is there were two peaks in gobies that stand out above others from the bottom trawl survey. We don't know how much weight to put in, you know, this measure, to be honest with you. We think that because gobies like to live on hard substrate, rocky areas, that this bottom trawl survey is, you know, really probably not the ideal way of trying to measure their abundance. So, you know, the conclusions that I'm willing to draw from this plot are pretty limited. We do have some work that's been going on over the past few years by Pete Esselman and his crew to look at other ways of measuring goby abundance, but we're not at the point where we can create a time series with that data set yet. Sculpins are important in Lake Michigan because they serve as food for a number of species, especially lake trout and burbot. Probably just about everything eats the young of these because the larvae of these two species is up in the water column. We catch them all the time in our midwater trawl surveys. But you can see from really 2013 in the case of slimy sculpins and 2008 in the case of the deep water sculpins that we've had really, really low and persistently low biomass for both of these organisms. Next, I would like to try and talk to you about some of our work that I call or labeled earlier as advanced tech. It's just advanced technology. And the focus of the work that I'm involved in is on trying to understand the sources of error or bias that might be present in our acoustic surveys. We know that anytime you do a survey, it's not going to give you what I call an absolute abundance estimate. It's not able to tell you exactly how many fish there are or how many birds there are or, you know, whatever it is you're surveying, because there are all kinds of things that happen in the sampling process that make it virtually impossible to count every single organism. So in the case of the acoustic surveys, we have what I would call three basic categories of potential error or bias. And hopefully I've tried to show these in this graphic on the right that I stole from Pete Esselman. The first one is vessel noise. And as you can imagine, you know, vessel noise is something that can be pretty intense if you're dealing with ships that are, you know, 50 to 100 feet long, often with multiple propellers and multiple diesel engines. We know from research done in the oceans that vessel noise can have a really large influence on the density estimates for fish, and that often those estimates are low because of fish avoiding the ship. They just don't like the noises. The second one, which I've sort of represented with this grayish shading up near the ship, is what we call the acoustic blind zone. It's a blind zone because that's an area that is so close to our transducers that we typically have attached to or sticking through the bottom of the ship's hull that we can't estimate fish density there. In fact, in some cases, fish are above the transducer. So we simply can't see that part of the water column. We know from work that's been done in Lake Ontario that alewife densities can be underestimated by as much as 50% in this blind zone, or because of this blind zone, but it does vary in time and space, and it's really not clear, you know, how consistent it is. We also know that Lake Superior prayfish density, primarily rainbow smelt and cisco, was estimated by as much as 65% by missing fish in this upper blind zone or acoustic blind zone. But it also can vary spatially and with time, and we don't yet have the ability to predict when this underestimate will be maximum or minimum. And the work we're doing right now is geared at helping us predict when this acoustic blind zone is going to be problematic. And lastly, we have the bottom acoustic dead zone, which should be shown in this graphic by the gray shading near the bottom. So basically, this is similar to the acoustic dead zone because of the way the sound spreads in the water column. It will miss some fish within some distance of the bottom. And some species like walleye pollock, which represent one of the most economically valuable fisheries in the world, maybe the most valued, can really be underestimated because of fish being in this acoustic dead zone. In Lake Michigan, the primary species that we have to deal with at night that are in this zone would be bloater, or in some cases in Lake Huron, rainbow smelt. So in order to try and answer questions in these three categories, again, vessel noise, the blind zone, and the dead zone, we've started carrying out some sampling that includes measuring the noise radiated by the ships. You know, in order to know how to model the way the avoidance of a ship varies with time or space, it's really important for us to know just how noisy that fish is and at what frequencies the noise is radiated, because certain frequencies can be heard by fish and other frequencies can't. So we teamed up with Michigan Tech to do this, and so far we have managed to measure the noise profiles of the Baird, which is the Fish and Wildlife Service vessel, the Steelhead, which is the Michigan DNR vessel for Lake Michigan, the Sturgeon and Arcticus and Kaiai, which are USGS vessels on Lakes Huron, Michigan, in the case of Sturgeon and Arcticus, the Kaiai, in the case of the Kaiai, that works on Lake Superior. We also made a pretty significant effort to compare the density of fish from different vessels in the same place and time. In this case, we're not comparing the Baird to the Steelhead or the Baird to the Sturgeon. Instead, we're comparing one of those ships that I talked about earlier with something called a sail drone at the same time and site. And we limited our comparisons to the sail drone because the sail drone is pretty much silent. It is a wind-driven vessel. It has no propeller. All it has is a rudder, and it's amazingly quiet, but the acoustic system set up on it is quite similar to that of a fish. I think I've got a picture a little later. So the last thing we're going to do to try and look at the upper blind zone and the bottom dead zone is to collect data with an AUV. We started doing that in 2022 in Lake Superior and Lake Michigan. And this thing is pretty cool because it has an echo sounder that pings both upward and downward, so it can see fish close to the surface and close to the bottom. We haven't even begun to analyze those data yet, but we do finally have them. So this slide shows a picture of some of the vessels we're talking about. It's from a paper that was submitted based on the Lake Michigan work that we did in 2021. On the upper left, you see the orange thing. That's the sail drone. That is actually one of the sail drones that we worked with in 2021. You see on the upper right, the Fish and Wildlife Service vessel. The lower left, the Michigan DNR vessel, the Steelhead, and the lower right, the USGS vessel, the Sturgeon. These are all reported on in this paper that's been submitted for review. And the kind of data that we're talking about looks like this. It's taken me a while to figure this out. But the simple way of putting it is on the x-axis of these plots, you have the frequency of the noise that's generated. So the further to the right, the higher the frequency or more close to the human hearing range you get, whereas on the y-axis, the up and down is just how loud it is. We have a dashed line in each of these plots that occurs at the same location in all of the plots. That represents a recommendation of sound levels radiated by acoustic research ships that has been put together from people that do work in the oceans. And basically the goal recommended by this group in the oceans is to have your ship noise radiate lower than the level shown in the black line. So we see different vessels here. The top is the Baird. Second is the Steelhead, third is the Sturgeon, and last is the Sail Drone. And you can see in the Sail Drone that it's virtually silent. It's far, far, far lower than this recommended level for acoustic research vessels, whereas the other three ships tend to be pretty close to or over that recommended noise level. The basic reason for that is none of these ships have actually been modified to be quiet, if you will. It's just not something that has been a priority for USGS. I don't think, I can't speak to the other agencies. I will say that the Steelhead, awesomely, is well below this dashed line for much of the range of radiated noise. So I think we're in good shape with the Steelhead, and we could use some improvement on the other ships. Having said all that, I think it's important to note as well that, this process is complicated, and these are our best estimates that we get by having a ship travel near a listening device that records the sound level at different frequencies and depths. Even though all three of the ships that I just showed exceed this recommendation by the ICES group, the International Council for Exploration of the Sea, we don't see any evidence that this is causing problems with our acoustic estimates relative to the Sail Drone, which is virtually silent. And we know that because we've got this work where we compared the Sail Drone and ships compiled in this paper that's been submitted by Tom Evans at Cornell. The way the work is done is, we've had this on the right-hand side, the Sail Drone, and on the left-hand side, the ship. The Sail Drone would travel along a line for a specified distance, and the ship would approach along the same line from behind the Sail Drone, and we would then be able to look at the acoustic densities from the Sail Drone as the ship approached and as the noise levels from the ship increased. And what one would expect is that if the ships are scaring fish away, the densities with the Sail Drone should decrease as the ship gets closer. I threw a picture of this AUV in here as well. I mentioned that earlier, and that's the thing that looks at both the upper blind zone and the bottom dead zone. We don't have anything to report for that yet. But again, we do for this ship Sail Drone comparison from Lake Michigan. That's a close-up of the Sail Drone, the AUV, and this is a path of the sampling done by the Sail Drones in 2021 in Lake Michigan. I honestly can't remember how many miles of sampling it was, but it was a huge amount. And we had a large number of cases where the ship overtook the Sail Drone to collect comparative data. And this plot shows those comparative data. And you can see in this plot along the x-axis is what I like to call the distance of the vessel to the Sail Drone. So on the right-hand side of the plot is where the vessel met the Sail Drone. On the left-hand side of the plot is where we started comparing data, the maximum distance of 2 kilometers. This plot shows in the left-hand column data from the Fish and Wildlife Service vessel, the Baird, and the next two columns, the other two vessels. And basically what we should see in this plot is the points on this plot should increase to the right. They should be higher to the right if in fact the vessel is causing, I mean, should get lower on the right if the vessel is in fact causing fish avoidance that is detected by the sail drone. So each dot represents a measure of fish density measured by the sail drone at that point in time over multiple attempts to do these comparisons. And again, the data on the right should be lower if the ship scares fish away. And that's just not what we see. We just don't see any pattern. In fact, what we find is there's little evidence that the noise generated by the fish has an influence on fish density, which is great. Now, saying that there's little evidence that the noisy ships measure different fish density is one thing. And that tells us that that's part of this puzzle that we can start to sort of, I don't want to say ignore, but place less weight on. That doesn't mean that we don't still have errors or sources of bias that lead to incorrect density estimates from these surveys. And that's where the work coming in, looking at the upper blind zone and the bottom dead zone matter. Next, I would like to talk a little bit about plans for the 2023 field season. What we have planned right now is actually a lot like what we did in 2021, 2022. In the case of forage or prey fish assessments, we'll carry out, or we're planning to carry out, the same things that we did in 2022. There's a spring bottom trawl survey planned for mid-April with the same sampling design as was carried out in 2022. That's something that we're prepping for now. I think we're also planning to add acoustic sampling to that survey so we can try to measure whether or not there are fish above the bottom trawl that we might be missing. One of the things that has been raised as a potential problem with our bottom trawl surveys is that fish just might be above the trawl. Sampling with acoustics at the same time that we're bottom trawling allows us to measure that. We'll be able to see if there's fish there or not. We're also planning on carrying out our annual surveys, the acoustic survey and what we call the fall forage assessment. That's the fall bottom trawl survey. So the acoustics will take place in August and the bottom trawl is September. During the acoustic survey, what we plan is to include additional sampling with the sail drone and that AUV that I mentioned. We do not yet have a plan for what we'll be doing with those two platforms, how and where we'll be sampling. That's something that we've been working on with the lake committees, the lake tech committees, and the study group that is working on this. This is a really large group of people from more agencies than I am able to count across all 5 of the Great Lakes. In addition to the sampling happening in Lakes Michigan and Huron in 2023, there's also sampling that's going to be happening in Lake Erie. One other thing that I think I like to joke about is integration of a new automated or semi-automated data recording system on both the vessels that work on the acoustic and bottom trawl surveys. This technology should bring these ships into the 20th century because they use 20th century technology that NOAA has been using on some of their survey vessels since the 1990s. And the goal of these steps is to improve the workflow and reduce the number of times I have to go back and correct a latitude or a bottom depth or whatever that was caused by somebody writing something in by hand. Basically, what it does is it connects the ship's sounder and the ship's GPS and the ship's thermometer and the ship's weather system to a larger system so that when you hit a button, it records a digital signal from all of those instruments that that the ship has. Again, this is 20th century technology that should help us a lot. So I don't have anything beyond a big thank you to bearing with me through what was a pretty data-rich talk.